Business Hour, 90.1 FM.
It's time to talk business,
specifically community business, on Community Business Hour with the You Can Do It team. Every Tuesday at noon, business-minded folks join the conversation with insight and information on how they took on the sometimes overwhelming challenges of business. Each contributing voice is a firm believer
in helping you become a stronger social economic contributor.
Here on Community Business Hour,
we know the right information can change your life.
Community Business Hour is for anyone wanting to be around local business-minded people. Whether you're starting or growing a business,
running a nonprofit,
or seeking employment,
the You Can Do It team
is on air and online for you.
Phone lines are open,
713-526-8737. And you can connect with us across the social media spectrum at CB Hour.
Now let's talk some business.
All right, welcome. Another week. We're here. You're here. It's time to talk business. John Willie, a.k.a. Jonyprofit, here at 90.1 KPFT HD3. I'm in studio right now live, here to talk business with you today. So we're changing things up a little. I've had a few ideas. I've thought this through. As with any business venture, things change. You know, I was listening. There's the fundraiser going on right now for the station, and we're working to raise money to keep the station going and thriving and doing great things. And I thought to myself, you know, Dwayne, the manager here, had mentioned that anything below, I think it's like 90 or 90 something on the dial, is for education and information. And so I want to make sure I brought you one or the other. OK, so I do a lot of public speaking on the topic of entrepreneurship because I'm an active participant in that space. I enjoy winning and getting things done and succeeding. So that's why I enjoy startups. I like startups or growth or improvements. I'm not big on managing things at all. I will come in and make it better, but there are people out there that may not either have that drive or that creative juice or that wherewithal to take the things that come with startups, primarily change and other humans that work your nerves. But that's the space I entered, and that's where I like being. So with that all being said, today's show is about the 10 steps necessary to think more like an executive entrepreneur. And the reason it's important that we start looking at how you think versus what you do is because how you think dictates pretty much what you do. So over the years, so now we're talking 25 years of me being in business and me being around business and me working with business owners to help their business. I was never there to sell them a widget. I was not there to sell them marketing. I wasn't there to sell them cash register machines or anything like that. I've always been in pretty much the capacity of business developer, market developer, second CEO, second entrepreneur, second pair of eyes. Hey, help me grow this thing. So I got an opportunity to look at business as a whole, not just from one spectrum. So you'll rarely ever hear me say, you know, if you do this one technique, it's going to work. If you do this one thing, it's going to improve your business. Instead, it was about if you have a better understanding overall, just a better understanding overall of economics, of human behavior, of project management, of communication, of the skill sets necessary to make you a strong business person, you'll do a lot better. Just from coming from the haveless side, like literally coming from the haveless side and then making it to the have side, then going back to the haveless side and going back and forth and back and forth as I try new things. The big difference when I'm hanging with my peers and my associates in a certain, let's just say, haveless environment, you just think differently. Culturally, like there's a cultural difference in how we think. And a lot of times we hear it when we're talking about test taking, applying for certain applications and loans and grants and funding, that there's a bias. There's a cultural bias to it. And cultural bias is very real. And in our country, there's a huge cultural bias, I would say, that handicaps the entrepreneur. So what happens is entrepreneurs think that small business is about taking risk, because all books say, hey, if you want to start a business, an entrepreneur means you take risk. You go out there and you give it your all and your passion and you do all this. And for some, that may be all they have, and that's what mindset they bring. But for the 1%, we'll just take them for example, because most people chase after what the 1% have: cars, planes, money, houses, fancy things, big trips, huge birthday parties, lavish buildings named after them. I mean, whether you like it or not, ego and guilt drives our economy and our society. And when people are sitting there 70,000 deep watching a game, they long to be either a winner or the people on the field, or to have the money that the people have on the field. But you long for something. Otherwise, you'd be out there doing it. You wouldn't be like sitting there watching somebody else succeed. You find other things to do with your life. So with that said, we have to start working on that mindset and get you to start understanding these 10 principles that over the years I've kind of like worked on and developed and shaped and tested and tried on different groups. So my 10 years with SCORE allowed me as a volunteer to work with entrepreneurs, work with small business owners, like around the clock, just about, you know, every day of the week. I was sitting with a person that said, I want to start a business. Here's my idea. I want to open a janitorial service. I'm like, oh, okay, whatever works. You know, I want to sell something. And so I had to figure out, how do I make it work for a person that may not have the credit? They may not have the education to manage this thing. They may not have the experience to start a small business. How do I help them get ahead? Especially fast track, like cut through all the hype, cut through all the extracurricular activities, and get to what are the 10 things you must know in order to have a shot. Doesn't mean you're going to succeed, okay? But at least you'll have a shot. So just like last week, we had 10 things on the workflow. I'm going to go through the 10 things that I need for you to start thinking about, start focusing on, start to understand. And as always, if you're a consultant or you're a marketing guru and, you know, you feel this information will help your business, you know, at least ask permission. You know, reach out at jw@eethinking.com and say, hey, can I use your material? Because a lot of you are doing some shady stuff out there. It's just, you know, we can talk about it. You know, it is what it is. And you're undermining your own clients because you're digging into territory you don't have the experience. And you're telling people things that you don't know about. And so when I'm explaining things to you, I'm telling you from firsthand experience, these are the things that I know. So with that said, if you're out there and you're, you know, collecting that 1500, that 3500, you're on Facebook talking about how you're balling out of control and your clients and all that, listen to this material. You know, I'm currently finishing up this whole MBA program because, again, in order to get good at my tool or craft, I have to keep, you know, sharpening the blade. So I went back to say, let me get this MBA instead of always knocking the MBA. Let me go back and get the bachelor's in marketing instead of knocking marketing. So that way I could at least say, hey, been there, done that. I got a decent understanding. I am trained in that field. So I feel where you're coming from. And the things that I'm going to tell you have nothing to do with any of that. It's important. Without those, you won't know how to work in a corporate environment well or efficiently or effectively. But the things that I'm going to share with you are really going to like just make you a better overall executive entrepreneur. So before we get started, just me in studio today. Phone lines are open, 713-526-8737. I think I actually know how to push the buttons to get it work, you know, if you decide to call in. But we're going to take a quick break so I can take a breather. And when we come back, we're going to get into the 10 things that I really think will help you become a better business-minded person. Doesn't matter if you use it at work. Doesn't matter if you use it on your own business. It doesn't matter if you use it with your nonprofit. So let's go to break. We'll be right back.
Hello, I'm Sally Tyler, Executive Director of Executive Service Corps of Houston, or ESH. ESH is a nonprofit business management firm that gives other nonprofits affordable tools with which to succeed. With over 25 years of nonprofit experience, mostly in development and public relations, I, along with seasoned consultants and board, help nonprofits achieve their missions more efficiently and effectively. For example, if you keep receipts in a shoebox or you're still tracking your donor gifts in Excel, our group can suggest more proficient ways that could move you forward. Nonprofits may not even recognize that they need help, and often they misidentify their needs. So when organizations come in to learn strategic planning, they may discover that there's a lack of resources or they have underutilized staff. Some of our partners include the Houston Food Bank, the Houston Arboretum and Nature Center, ISDs, and small agencies, multicultural centers. We truly understand their needs because we're a nonprofit too. We utilize business professionals, both currently employed and retired, with years of experience, many from Fortune 500 companies. And now, some nonprofit professionals too, both development and marketing pros who can help your organizations with strategic and development planning, marketing, accounting, human resources, and policy issues. Esh helps nonprofits excel. It's not sexy work, but it is necessary. Organizations have great missions, but may not be able to communicate their messages effectively. They may not have thought through their long-term plans, yet both are vital to achieving funding and rallying support for their organization. Everything from finding qualified staff to locating the best office space, and most importantly, achieving their mission, hinges on these issues. Esh can help. Please help us help organizations around Houston do the great work they need to do. We need you to do that. Thank you.
Welcome back to Community Business Hour. You're on 90.1 KPFT HD3.
All right, so welcome back. All right. So we're going to talk about the 10 things. Phone lines are open 713-526-8737. And I promise if I hear it ring, I'll try to figure out how to answer it. If I don't, tweet me or something. So one of the things we're going to work on is we had EE Hour, the Executive Entrepreneur Hour, before when we're on another frequency, another station, and I let that thing go. It was a great experiment. I wanted to see that I could do four cameras, studio full of people, and just have a real live marketing machine with live YouTube streaming straight to SoundCloud, all that real cool fancy stuff as a one-person operation. I'm really big on automation. Fewer people, fewer headaches. That's just how it goes. I mean, any of you that are out there that are really pushing it, really taking yourself to the next level, really driving, you know firsthand, more people, more problem, more customers, more money. So you try to work that balance right there. So anyway, getting back to the top 10 things, it goes a little something like this. Let me get my mic positioned so I could see and talk at the same time. Hey, Anthony's in there. All right, so the number one thing you really need to look at has to do with your vision, okay? Vision is often overlooked. So last week when we were talking about the binder, we were looking at the why of things and why you do certain things, okay? But really what I want you to think about is the vision. So I pull the vision sheet out so I can remember some of it. One of the things we ask you to do, really assess this. So let's just say you just got laid off. You're one of the 600, 2,000, 3,000. You just got laid off. You're waiting to be retooled, to be thrown back into the system to once again, you know, generate income, add value to someone else's system. But in the meantime, you're thinking about maybe you will start your own business. Maybe you'll do your own thing. So you jump out there, but you either go into a space you know absolutely nothing about or you go into a space that's very crowded. So I ask you to do this. When it comes to visualizing your big picture, it should be a financial big picture. I can't stress enough how important it is to think money when talking about business. I mean, let the passion people do their passion. I mean, it's beautiful. Like I always say, you need a lot of passion when you're doing things absolutely wrong and it's not working. You do. You need that stay with all. But anyway, when it comes to looking at the big picture, your financial big picture, you need to do the self-assessment. You really need to ask yourself the why, which is what we started with last week in your binder. And the why covers things like this. It covers, you know your assets, like literally know your assets. Who are the things, people, and most importantly, knowledge in between your head that can really make a difference, that can really add value, that gives you that power when you step out there. And you'll remember, I think it was like number 9 or 8 on the binder list, that contact, know your people. You are a product, or you basically, your energy comes from how much you know, how many people and who you know, and the things that you possess or can get your hands on, all right? So just think that through. Once you kind of know your assets, you know where you stand physically, what you offer, you really got to determine your needs. And that's something that I guess you just keep thinking if you'll build it, it will work. And right now, there was a procurement meeting this morning. I wasn't able to attend because I kind of got the feeling it'd be the same people doing the same thing, saying the same thing, because they haven't walked through these 10 steps. And these 10 steps really help you vet whether or not a project or a business is a go or no-go, which, once again, something you learn in corporate, something you learn in the military, but it's rarely something you hear in small business. It might be one little section. It might be a paragraph in your used-to-be management book, then small business book, and now they scratched all that off and put entrepreneurship on there. And so you take a class and it says, go or no go. Let's find out if a business is worth doing. Is it a dream or is it an opportunity? Okay. But you need to really stop and think about on anything that you decide to do, whether it is truly a go or no go. it's okay to say no go. It is absolutely okay to scrap a project, to scrap a... Look, there's buildings sitting out here worth millions of dollars, pipelines, all that. Big companies know they don't want to throw good money after bad money. The most small business owners are tricked, misled, misguided in believing if you just keep throwing at... You know what? They got the little... You know, you give up in the last 10%, the last 80% of the struggle is when you're supposed to really buckle down and stick to it. If you did a proper assessment, you know if that was true or false. In most cases, it's false. You should have got to get out while the getting was good. Anyway, once you know your assets, you go over there and you need to really start to think about what are you willing to commit and what do you really need from all this? Do you need money? Do you need to have your ego stroked? Why are you starting the business? Because if you don't know why you're doing this, if you're kidding yourself, you're doing it because you think it's what your parents want to see you do, or you think it's because of, I don't know, you pick it. But a lot of times the why, internal why, does not pair up with like anything you've set out to do. Like you say to yourself, I'm doing this because I want to help people, when really inside you want attention. You say you set out because you want to make a lot of money, but you make a lot of non-money decisions because in reality you're just doing it to get attention. And so just figure that stuff out. After that, when we're looking at the big picture, you need to really start to discover what's the potential, what is the size. When we talk about, I have a great idea, will it actually work? Like, to discover my potential has to do with who do I have compassion for? Not passion for, not sympathy for. Who do I have compassion for? Who do I feel like if I could help would really help me out by making me feel better? And then you got to look at the size of that community that you have compassion for. Is it a big community? Is it a small community? Is it a community that's spread out across the world? Are you selling brownies? And are you selling like gluten-free brownies and you have a distribution pattern around the world? Well, you need a way to bring that group together, that community. You need to know them. And then lastly, look at your contribution. What is it that you can bring when we go back to know your assets, things, people, and knowledge? How do you turn your knowledge into an asset or a deliverable? So when we look at that, lastly, we look at your deployment platform, okay? This is all big picture. This is over coffee, drinks, the hot tub, racquetball, golf, whatever, skiing, whatever you do, okay? You're doing this as this like a sit back and really think this through. And you say, what's my deployment platform? And deployment platforms are consistent or consist of communication, psychology, and project management. That's how we build ours. So in other words, we got to make the public aware. We have to make our internal team aware of our intent, of what we expect. So we turn around and we build these incredible communication systems, much of which you can go online and Google or YouTube and find neat videos and training for. And then we look at the psyche of it. Now that we can communicate, we can understand what the customer wants. We can understand what our suppliers want. We can stand in the shoes of our employees or our contractors, and we have a very clear understanding of their psyche, of their mind, of their mindset. We can use that to help motivate. We can help make them more productive. We can do things because it's not about us. It's about making money for everybody and adding value across the chain. And then lastly, part of our deployment platform really is about being a good project manager. And I told you before, you don't have to go do all that PMP stuff. That's overkill. Overkill. Go get a book. Go watch some videos. Use all the resources online to just find out what are the basic principles of project management, okay? So when you roll all that up, we make a deliverable to the big market, and now we got this sketch, a napkin, a drawing that says, hey, these are the things I could do. Wow, now that I know me, I know the market, I got a delivery platform I think will like work that's not based on any one deliverable. It's just based on some fundamental principles of doing business. This is awesome. So that's the first one, and if you're going to watch this later on, this is what it looks like, all right? So let's move on to number two. So when it comes to number two, this is the one, this is definitely the most overlooked when it comes to small business. When it comes to small business, okay, whether you're employed or you're not employed, or you know, you work a job or you're employed. People, for some reason, live in a vacuum, or they live on a bubble, or they live under a cup. I don't know if it's from entitlement. I don't know if it's just from being naive. I'm not sure what it is, because every time I speak to someone, I get a different feel from why they don't understand things that I now take for granted. Number two has to do with understanding the economic, what we call hyper-snapshot. In other words, what we want to know is, where's all the money that I need to feed my family or pay my employees or contractors? Where does it all come from? It isn't magically printed. It isn't, you know, there's a system to this madness. And so at some point, you as a business owner or someone looking for a job have to, you know, take a step back and put on the grown-up pants and start thinking like a grown-up and start thinking at a much higher level, where it isn't a matter of, I get money because money exists and I work hard. No, you are able to receive funds because somewhere there's a company or an organization in your region that exports a good or service to a domestic group or an international group in exchange for money. And they take that money, they run their business, and they feed the community. Their employees eat, they bank, they shop, they get their nails done, they go to the movies, they do all this stuff. And if you don't understand who the economic leaders are, who are the people that actually drive your economy, if you don't understand who those key players are, you will never have the opportunity to pretty much sit at the table at will. You might be lucky enough to have a friend or a buddy that's on a winning team at that time, and you jump in there and you're feeling good about yourself, and you know, well, business is up. I don't know why everybody's crying. Business is good. I don't know. Everybody's out here crying about oil and gas. I'm doing good. Well, that's great. But as I said, most business owners can't repeat success because they don't understand economics. They're literally running their mouth based on, you know, what they saw rather than what they actually know or understand. So number two is really about, you need to get a complete grasp of the economics of your environment. Who's making the money? Who are the suppliers? Where are the people that work there? Where do they live? All this data is available online. All this data is for you to go out there and make informed decisions before you start a business. Okay? There's a report today on the radio at what are we, like 20 minutes past the hour? There was a report as I was driving into the studio that talked about, you know, the West End of Houston is going to experience some hard times. You know, real estate, commercial real estate is, you know, it's a buyer's market now. They overbuilt, the market crashed, oil prices are down to almost, you know, anywhere between $30 and $27 a barrel. It's really hurting. Then they turn around and feature the fact that, you know, maybe this means more for consumers because they can spend. If you don't understand what they're talking about, and you invest your money in marketing people, you invest your money in learning culture, you invest your money in more business plans, you're throwing away a lot of good money. Because it's going to be hit or miss whether you succeed if you do not understand where the money in your environment comes from. If you're doing business online and you're dealing with people overseas, you better know where your customers get their money from and where their employer gets their money from. That way you can hedge your bets. That way you can plan ahead. Otherwise, you're always going to be at the mercy of the market. All right, so let's go to number three. Number three happens to be... dun-dun-dun... structuring executive deals. So one of the things I notice, there's an order, there's a pecking order. And I mentioned this last week, there's an order in which you do business. When you start a business or decide to do the growth thing or whatever you're going to do, there's an order to it. And you must follow that order. If you don't follow that order, guess what? Bad things happen. So part of following that order has everything to do with who are the first people you talk to. I mean, I'll say you get an idea, usually get an idea from hanging around people that have good ideas or that are stimulating you, getting you going, making you think, awesome, awesome, awesome. What do you do after that? Well, as I mentioned before, and this is number three, step three, structuring the executive pre-deals. And step three, it's all about protecting what it is you plan to take to market. I can't stress that enough. If you can't protect it, someone else will, and they'll probably run away with it and make most of the money from it. If you can't protect it, then it's probably not worth doing to begin with. And that's just how it is. So the first person you need to deal with outside of your think tank group, the group that keeps you motivated, fired up, like, God, I love being around you because when I'm with you folks, it's just like, wow, I get all these awesome ideas. I get all this energy. I'll talk about people later, but that's another subject. First person you have to have in your life is someone of, shall we say, legal stature, a lawyer, an attorney, someone who understands law, someone that can help you protect your ideas and concepts. Because if you can't protect it, whether formally or informally, you're going to be in a world of hurt. Basically, you have absolutely nothing to sell. And you see it all the time on these business shows and they'll ask, how much money have you made? And the person will say, I've made a lot. And they're like, well, do you have intellectual property, or, you know, have you protected the idea? And they'll say no. And then everybody kind of look at each other like, he's brought a great, or she's brought a great idea. Let's run with it. If they said yes, they're like, cool, now we can talk. We can put the laws behind whoever tries to copy it or, you know, jump on your idea. We can roll with it. So protecting your idea is number one. No marketing, no website, none of that. Go sit down with your attorney and ask, can I protect this idea? Is it worth protecting? Once you know yay or nay one way or the other, it doesn't mean you do it or don't do it. It just means you either can or you can't. You go see a CPA. You go see someone that's going to help you start to crush the numbers. So now that you know what you want to do, you've done that big sketch outline of how you think it may work. Now you get out there and you start procuring like the big pieces, like, okay, I want to open, let's say, a trucking company. So you have this cool idea behind a trucking company that is, you know, guided by drones, and this thing is really cool and it's intermodal and you can do all this fancy stuff with your new trucking company. Your attorney said, yes, 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 we can patent this idea. We can trademark that. We can copy this. We can do all this great stuff. We can make a killing on this. Then your CPA person sits down with you and says, let's run the good, better, and best numbers. And let's see the different scenarios in which we can either raise money, save money, and put this together so that if we have to go out and raise capital or we have to go out and start making purchases, we have a very good idea of our cash flow, our assets, our debt to equity. We know all this stuff before we make any decisions. Those are the top two people every single time. Top two people, structuring a deal, you always start with somebody to protect the idea, and then you go straight to the person that's going to help you monetize the idea. After that, it's just straight consultant phase. Your top consultants are going to be your HR, marketing, operations. It might be an overseas IT team, whatever. And as I said before, you call them not to do the job. You pay them to give you best case scenarios of how it can work. So that phase three of this setup is really about contacting industry best, not the people walking into your office, not the people on Facebook and LinkedIn talking about, I'm the best. Look at me. Look at me. Oh, I've seen jumping off an airplane. I'm so awesome. All my clients. No. I love LinkedIn for the simple purpose. I can go in, look you up, then go see if anybody else is talking about you. Notice you've got a TEDx, a real one, and notice you've written some papers. Notice universities are following. Notice a lot of things. Make that connection and then ask you, and I'll pay, of course, and you should pay as well because you're going to pay for a lot of other things. Hey, will you please help me map out the following, and what is your fee? Map out the perfect scenario for logistics for my new intermodal gyrocopter guided trucking company. Hey, you're great with HR and transportation. You do my HR, you do my marketing, great. Bring all that back together, and then we go into another phase that we're not going to get into. So I just want you to understand that when it comes to structuring any deal, we always start with the awesome folks at a law firm and then the really awesome folks at a CPA firm, okay? So that's number three. When we go to number four, we're going to do number four, then we're going to go to break because we're almost 30 minutes past the hour. And you're listening to Community Business Hour, which I think is going to go back to Executive Entrepreneur Hour here on 90.1 KPFT. I really do. I'm going to find out later after the show. So anyway, when we go on to number four, it's really close to like number two as far as capturing that snapshot. Number four has everything to do with, especially if you're undecided, you're about to get laid off, things are rough, you don't know what you're going to do, okay? And you're trying to come up with all these ideas, and you're going to go to a franchise show, and you're going to read the back of Entrepreneur Magazine, you're going to go through Craigslist, you're going to go to a business broker, you're going to talk to all these friends and family, you're going to do all this, and they're going to tell you all this great stuff, buy a McDonald's, right? Or better yet, go buy a Chipotle, right? The reality of it is, it's very, very, very simple. The hedge fund guys know how to do it for the most part. The investment community folks know how to do it. Everybody but the worker bees understand this simple concept. If you find the resource center and you know where the money's coming from, there's a certain kind of like almost Maslow. There's a pecking order that builds up, all right? And that order goes, there's an acquisition team that's there to help, you know, put it all together and whatever the idea, whatever brings money into your town. Let's say you live in a small town and has a big university there with a big time football program, and that program drives the whole community because you guys have a national championship now, and they feed everybody, clothe everybody, they make it happen. Well, there's a pecking order. Acquisition team came in, and that team may have been one to get the land to build a college, move up a couple years. Acquisition team is going to be always to go get a better football team or a better coach or a better stadium. Once that acquisition team is there and they're done, the security team comes in, and the security team are people that are skilled at protecting the assets of those who recently got some. And so their job is going to be to protect assets from man, nature, and time. After that, there's going to be a group that their whole focus will be on labor. And they're going to come in and they're literally going to teach the labor how to best use the new resource, be it the super football team that's going to win another national championship team. If you live in Houston, you'll know that Super Bowl 51 is on the way. 2017, it's coming to Houston. And now we look at the acquisition team. They've been here for a while. Everybody's jockeying for a position so that they can get a contract. They want a piece of that NFL money. Good luck with that, because most of you aren't organized enough to get a piece of that. But that's another discussion, and we'll talk about it on another day, okay? So that labor group comes in, and they train up the labor. They train up the people who do the work. They train up the people who help the people who help the people. So if you're in training, you look at where we are with this whole NFL thing coming. Are you able to come in and train people? Safety training, equipment training, process training. There's a lot of training that goes on when somebody's willing to bring a couple $1 billion to your town. So when it comes to that labor part and bringing in the resources, the machines, the beast machines, and equipment to do the work, they process the resource, right? Then comes the culture. So now you got a bunch of people working, and they're starting to split off in different groups and do their thing. You got to look at, maybe you're going to be the person to make a bunch of money off the culture aspect of it. You're the nightclub owner. You're the eatery. You're that person that, wow, I can see how this is growing. I'm going to get in. I'm going to stop what I'm doing on this dying market on the other side of town, and I'm going to hedge my bet and get in over here and start building something to fuel the culture. And if that doesn't work, you got the community side of it. Think how many government agencies are looking forward to the hotel taxes, to the food taxes, to the transportation taxes, to all the things that are going to go on, as well the heartache of trying to harbor that many people in that short period of time. So now's a huge opportunity if you're big on helping govern the resource at a community level. And then lastly, the environment. When you look at the environment, and keep in mind, this is how it grows. It goes from a group acquires. Once it's been acquired, a group secures it. Once it's been secured, a group brings in the labor to process the resource. Once it's been actually processed, then there's a group that comes in and educates so that we can do better, more effective, more efficient. Then as that group gets used to hanging around with each other, they build a culture and start hanging out and kicking it and having a good time. And once that culture starts to divide up the who's who, we get a community. And once that community really starts to evolve and grow, then they got to have pretty stuff. They got to have parks. They got to have separation of rich and poor. They got to have all these neat things. So I want you to focus on that. And I want you to understand that focusing on the monetary drivers, where do I fit in? And it's a lot to learn. I'll show you if you're going to watch the video later. Dun, dun, dun. That's what it looks like. All right. Showing it. If you're listening in, you go to our YouTube channel later and you can watch it. You can catch this. Go to our website, which is either going to be at EE Hour or CB Hour. So with that said, we're going to go to a quick break. I don't know if it'd be quick, but we're going to go to a break, and then when we come back, we're going to get back on what number 5 has to say. Here we go.
Looking to grow your existing business? America's SBDC Network can help. America's SBDC Network no-cost growth acceleration services provide in-depth consulting to assess your financials, optimize performance, uncover new opportunities, and accelerate business growth. Ready to grow? Visit us online or contact your local office to get started on your path to success today.
Houston Public Library links you to the world. And now, each one of us can have our own personal link to the world with the new Houston Public Library MyLink. MyLink gives you access to more than 6 million books and magazines, 130 online resources, 26,000 ebooks, and 5,000 movies for free. All for free, anytime, anywhere. I have my link. Do you have yours?
Community Business Hour, 90.1 FM.
Welcome back to Community Business Hours. You're on 90.1 KPFT HD3.
All right, so we're talking simple, fundamental basics of entrepreneurship, executive entrepreneurship, doing it in a way that no matter what you add on here on out, you'll have a very sound foundation, whether you do it from a formal college education or you go to more workshops or you look the stuff up online or whatever it is. stick with us and, you know, you might gain some insight. So going on to number five, all right? We just finished focusing on monetary drivers. When we look at number five, this one's called connecting with wealthy circles. And this is one of the harder ones because of social economics, class division, class warfare. Warren Buffett had the statement that I put on a lot of our work where it says there's a war between the haves and the have-nots, all right, and the haves are winning or kicking their butts or something like that. And it's true because there's a fundamental difference in thinking. And sometimes I'm challenged to think culturally, whether it's ethnicity or race, whatever, is there really a difference in the lifestyle or is it a difference because of economics? And it could go either way. So I don't even argue that position in my head because it would give me a headache. But what I know is when poor people hang around wealthy people, they make more money. When wealthy people hang around more or poorer people, they basically find followers. When poor people hang around poor people, you usually get some type of crab in the bucket greed effect. And when have or well-to-do people hang around well-to-do people, we usually end up in kind of a war, you know? It's like a power versus power, you know? Especially if both are jockeying for more, when they want more. They don't feel like they have enough, they gotta have more. So my goal in explaining this next slide or the deal in front of me is really about helping you understand that mindset matters. And there's so many people out here barking up the wrong tree, really spending their energy and spinning their wheels in areas that it will help somehow, but it may not be the fastest way to correct a wrong or correct an injustice or correct what's going on in their culture, in their society, in their group. So here's how it goes. All right. We've talked about money has to come in from somewhere, and it is a absolute fact that the majority of all money that comes in is controlled by certain groups of individuals, okay? Very little diversity at the top. It is what it is. It is what it is, all right? So as you come down, you realize, like, there's certain things that the top, the upper crest do that is complete reverse order from the have less, and it goes like this. Number five. When it comes to catering to, servicing, or delivering products, services, thoughts, things to the haves, the pecking order goes as such. The haves enjoy security first. Major investment goes towards security, protecting assets, protecting money, protecting family, protecting education. They spend money on security. When it comes to, well, let's go on. So after security, you know, you got in there, you got a budget, you've got a lot of money, and you've earned it, or you've stolen it, or whatever, have you got it, you know, you have money. You spend a lot on security. And sometimes security means you buy a very nice house in a very nice neighborhood, because that way you are insulated from others that may not share your mindset, your culture, your wealth, okay? Then they spend a fortune on information. They love to be informed, whether it's financial information, social information, economics, culture. They spend a lot on information. After that, they invest on the support side. They spend money on support. That's the person who cleans their house. That's the person, their administrative personal assistant. That's their Uber people. That's their limo. That's their private jet people. They pay for support. Then, and it's only because they have more discretionary cash, I'm sure, but I also think it's just because, actually, I don't think it has to do with discretionary cash, because I've seen very people who start with almost nothing use this exact same principle or flow, workflow with their funds to acquire more and more wealth. Next, after support, they spend on entertainment. They're going to be entertained, whether that's fancy stuff or just jumping off a cliff or going hunting in South Africa. Whatever it is, they love to be entertained as well. But it falls to number four on most important things. And then lastly, no matter how you chop it up, they enjoy being worshipped. Okay? And so by that, they will stick their name on the side of a zoo. They will stick their name on the side of a building. They will give money to a foundation. They'll pass out money anonymously, or they'll become very philanthropic, and they will stick their name on stuff. Sidewalks, trees, whatever, okay? The reverse. Now, that's the haves. And, you know, this is a case of a hit dog will holla, okay? And I just throw that in because I posted that to Facebook this morning. The haveless tend to work in the exact opposite way. And it goes like this. If you're broke or you're struggling, your mindset may be a little off. The haveless tend to, one, want to be worshipped. They want to be recognized. They will wear fancy things, whether they can afford it or not, or whether it's a knockoff or not. And this is a big sweeping generalization, so this isn't everyone. I already said there are more than enough people that I have met that started at the bottom, and now they're here. They're way up there. But I can tell you, almost for certain, they followed the haves method of where they place their money. On the haveless side, they start with worship first. Worship me. Look at me. Did you not see me? I have this now. I'm now this now. I just graduated now. I now have more letters behind my name now. Didn't you see me? They love to be worshipped. Facebook is like the poor person's, like CNN, MSNBC, 90.1. Facebook has allowed the have less to finally get what they've longed for, which is to have a voice and make people worship you the way they would like to, or hate how people worship the haves. Always looking at the haves, like, big deal, yeah. You wouldn't be all that if you didn't have all that money. You wouldn't be all that if you couldn't dunk the ball. You wouldn't be all that if you couldn't throw the football. You wouldn't be all that if you didn't have your PhD and run a medical. You wouldn't be any of that. Yeah. I'm like, oh, okay, well, you're a little salty, but it's okay. So after they spend a fortune on fancy stuff for you to see them in, the shoes, the phone, and all that good stuff, then they love to be entertained. That's number two, where they spend their money. And they want to be courtside. They want to be at the game. They want to be at the play. They want to be at the club. They want to be at the dance. They want to be third Thursday looking fresh and fly. That's where they spend their money and their time. So first they want to be worshiped. Then they want to be entertained. And then if there's any money left, they'll pay for support. They'll pay for somebody to dry clean their clothes. They'll pay for somebody to mow their front yard. They'll pay for somebody to do a few things here and there. And they'll usually go to the lowest bidder. You know, they're quick to learn procurement techniques then. And they'll go out there and they'll say, hey, you know what? I need support because I'm balling out of control and all these people are looking at me. I can't look poor. So I'm going to spend even more money on support. After that, and then only after that, do the have less really spend money on being informed. That's why I love being on 90.1. Okay, that's the cool part about now. I'm on a station that works to keep you informed. I'm down in the bottom half of the range on the dial where everybody around me, the community stations, the Rice, the U of H, we're all about giving you incredible information or giving you insight or giving you the complete story or giving you a whole story or giving you a different perspective to inform you without the commercialism behind it. And then, you know, they love to be informed, but ask yourself, what are you going to be informed about if your life starts with being worshipped, being entertained, and skimping out on support? You're going to probably be seeking information to figure out how you can be worshipped more, how you can be entertained better, and how you can get cheaper support. And then lastly, after something happens, then they want to buy security, whether it's car insurance, whether it's, oh, guess what, a family member just died, and now what happens? You got to ask everybody for money to bury a family member. Because all this time that you were spending on your, you know, super unlimited data plan and your high-speed cable and your 50-inch TV on $40,000 a year, now guess what? You need some security, and you can't afford it. And so it's amazing why the haves have a hard time speaking to the have-less and vice versa. Because the information flow, the priorities literally run opposite directions. And it's really cool to watch people go through the transformation as they start to pick up on this and like, well, you know, maybe if I make it less about me and more about, you know, protecting the little money that I have, or maybe becoming more informed about how to better protect the little money I have and how to better be informed, things will change. So I spent a lot of time on that, but I just wanted you to understand, like, it's okay if you take it personal, but it's not healthy if you take it personal when you start digging into the haves and the have less. Because it doesn't matter if gender difference, race, age, religion, none of that matters. Within each of those sects, sectors or those groups of people, the same philosophy holds true. You have rich women, poor women, rich blacks, poor blacks, Hispanics, Mexicans, whites, everything, Chinese, Asian. Inside of every single group, it's the same pattern. You have a top 1%, and now you have a 99%. So keep that in mind. I had to share that. I took way too much time. Okay, so moving on to the next one, and I'll show you this. I don't know. I think the camera went out a couple times, so I don't know what you're going to be watching when it's actually time to put this thing up. But anyway, when it comes to number six, we're looking at managing investor meetings. So now we're looking at, there is really a trick to raising money. Not a trick. There's a technique. There's a procedure you can follow. There's a way that works more than it doesn't work, and no one's hiding it from you. I'm a member of a lot of different programs that are, quote, helping small business owners. And when they bring in the financial guys or girls, financial people, when they bring them in, they say the exact same thing over and over again. So I've created, you know, like a workflow, mind map. What do they need? What do they want to hear? What's the procedure? How do you go it? What's the policy? At what point do you need a balance sheet, an income statement, a cash flow statement, a tax return, structure documents, compliance documents, forecast and budgets? When do you need that? When do you need controls in place? Or how do you manage your risk? What's acceptable risk? Right down to, you want to raise money. Do you even know why the person you're talking to will lend you money or invest in you? Are they doing it because they feel like they want to serve a purpose? Are they doing it because they feel like there's some prestige with being around you? Are there perks? Like, are you shooting a super movie and they just want to be on the set? Or is it simply what most of you think? It's ROI. It's a return on investment. And many people in the friends and family, they're not looking for so much the return on investment. They want to know they served a purpose in your life. And so there's a whole section that we focus on, or that you should start to get to know, as far as, hey, you know, how do I really manage investors? What do I need to do? What do I need to look for in an investor? So that's that. Let's move on to number seven. So number seven, it's very complicated. It's very complicated. I don't even know how to describe it. It's just this big blob. A few people have seen this slide before. And the purpose of it was to help people understand, I think what I was calling at the time, like the seven threes or something like that. Going back to people and why people give me a headache, and deep down inside, I want people to succeed because it gives me more people to work with. People get so distracted and caught up in their little silo, their little tiny world, their little perspective of everything, that they lose sight of big pictures, which is why we have so much going on in the world that we can call chaos. What I've found over the years is basically there's a few different people involved in the economic food chain, and there's a few entities involved. And so it goes like this. We've discussed, you know, the whole resource center where all of our money comes from. We know that oil and gas kept this city going. We know that along the way it allowed for the port, for SpaceX, for basically transportation, the refineries, the health hospital district. We know all that was able to come up. Even tech is starting to catch up. Movies are starting to catch up. We're building on the arts. We're doing all these great things because oil and gas was making so much money for that period of time. And now, quote, we're more diverse, you know, with agriculture and everything else in the state as a whole. But along the way, it's important to understand that we have a few entities that people often get confused, especially that haveless side of government, corporate, and small business. All right. Those are the big three that every small business owner should be able to distinguish the difference. And why you distinguish the difference between the three of those is because you have to know how to approach them. Most of you say the wrong thing to the wrong people at the wrong time. You talk to a government representative as though you were talking to a corporate agent. They're not the same. You speak to other small business owners as though they're a corporate, and it doesn't work like that. And so what we've been able to do is come up with information to help you understand basically the relationship they have to resources. What's a government agency's relationship to a resource? It's simply to protect it. How do they make money? They tax it. Who are their primary adversaries? Basically, people who own things. I mean, Trump is making a very clear statement in that The politicians on the stage with him are basically bought and paid for. He says it over and over. He says, I bought them. Yet you still run out in your little silo chanting and jumping up and down and doing backflips as though somehow that's going to change the reality of the economy. So you look at those three. The next thing, you have certain people, okay? You have owners. Those are the people who control the resources, the very resources you need. The water that might be getting dirtier, the air that might be getting dirtier, the food that might be getting more just like non-edible. They control the fuel, the everything. They're the owners. They're the investment class. They're the high net worth class. They own things. And then down from that, you have the working class. Their job is just to simply go out and process the goods. A basketball player's job is to go out and process that basketball. A doctor's job is to process that surgery, process that medicine. The post office guys, to process that envelope. All of you that if you have to get up and pull a check in, no matter where you are on the income bracket, no matter what your W-2 says at the end of the day, you're in that working class. And there's nothing wrong with being there if you take care of your money. And lastly, we have, well, not lastly, then we have the world poor. The world poor actually lack resources, and they're in the game for survival. But they add pressure to the working class. That's why they are the world poor and they're always on standby. But the most important person you'll ever know of, now we're looking at like the three entities and the four most important people, are the consumers. Consumers make the world go around, okay? What relationship do consumers have to resources? They work for them. When I walk through the mall or I walk through a shopping center and I see people filling up their baskets, filling up their bags, walking around with their fancy cars, doing all that stuff. On one end, as an investor, it makes me sad. On the other, it makes me I'm just excited beyond excited, because I know there's economic activity. People are buying. People are shopping. That wheel, that mouse on that wheel is running again. And that's a beautiful thing, because that creates economic mobility. Because where one person isn't satisfied and they want to spend money, they'll find somebody to satisfy them. So This chapter, which is 7, is really about understanding the whole ecosystem, the whole thing, how it works. So I won't dwell on it much more, because we're already like 50 minutes past the hour, okay? So let's go on to, I'll go to break, but you know, I'm just rambling right along here, and hopefully this is helping you out a little bit. All right, so when we go to number 8, this is one of those fun ones. It has what I call approaching the endless opportunities. And I'll just cut to the chase. One of the things you must really understand as now an executive entrepreneur, hereby deemed by John Whaley, Jonyprofit, AKA, and all that other good stuff, there's three ways to make money, and there's three things that change behavior so that we can make money. And again, all of you out there doing your marketing guru sale, and you got to go figure out how to get $1,500 out of one more person this week, Godspeed. May this help. The three things that make it possible for us to continue the whole consumerism, keep buying, the catalyst for opportunity, shall we call it, are technology, nature, and regulations, okay? And what I want you to think about now, when you're thinking about, man, okay, I got to figure out what's the next business I'm going to do? How am I going to do this? When we're looking at it internally and we're going to invest in somebody's organization, we're looking at it from this standpoint. If it's technology, it's the last place we want to invest. It really is. Because technology can be duplicated, it changes, but if you hit the right one and it's a home run, certain technology can exponentially expand, grow, build a market. Nature. We love nature. Like, I fly drones, helicopters. And when I first got mine like 10 years ago, before all the hype kicked in and, you know, they flooded the market, if there was a disaster, I could stick a helicopter up in the air, I could stick a drone in the air with a camera on it and make decent living, okay? So because of natural disasters or man-made incidents or people getting old or people, you know, birth rate, it opens up new opportunity, because then there's a change in behavior. But the most important one, the reason those folks in D.C. and Austin keep making money hand over fist while you stand there and complain, looking blindly into the dark, talking about, I can't see, what's going on? How come I can't get my piece of pie? It must be all them other people that ain't me doing it. Why? It's because of regulations. The fastest and easiest way to make money is to follow the rules and regulation. If they tell a university, if an accreditation group tells a university you can no longer sell a said book or teach in a certain way, it will force them to make changes. changes mean opportunity for you. If they raise the speed limit by 5 miles per hour, that's going to create a social behavioral change, which means now maybe you'll sell spoilers because cars can go faster, tires that perform better at higher speeds. There's so many opportunities behind regulations. And that's why we start right there. We follow the rules. We follow the rules because they impact human behavior. When there's a change in human behavior, there's new opportunities. Because if somebody's happy with their barber, why are they going to come to you? All the spamming and social media and blast e-blast in the world is not going to get them to deviate from the current, you know, unless they're just price jumping. And then in that case, they're going to jump off of you as soon as a better price comes along. And you really don't want that kind of customer. Otherwise, you're a commodity pusher. All right, so with that said, we look at it like this. Three ways, basically, you make money. You either finance deals, you deliver a product, or you educate. So when it comes to financing deals, if you got money sitting on the sideline, lots of it, sure, you know. But, you know, there's a certain amount of risk involved in that. So that's the last way we go to make money. But financing deals has made a lot of people that have a lot of money, a lot more money. When they have lack of access and you can deliver the product, it's awesome. So they're aware, they have money, they just can't get to it. Awesome. Set up a store and start moving units, start moving content, start moving stuff. But even that takes a little, you know, takes some infrastructure, takes some work. How we like to do business is to educate. We know a product exists. We know people have the money to buy it or the credit to buy it. All we have to do is inform them. So we design systems to get that information out to people that already are sitting pretty. They're ready, willing. We just got to make them able. And so I want you to think about that. Okay, I just want to get through these slides. All right, let's go to number 9. Number 9 is a blueprint that I built years ago, and the whole purpose of number 9 was to help you better understand that there is an absolute business model. There is a blueprint that you can put on your wall. We have it in the office and everywhere, and we scribble on it. The whole team can see it. I wanted to do away with business plans, and I wanted something that was more living, breathing, live, like right there. Project management doesn't offer this, so we needed a template that allowed us to walk past as a team and say, oh, here's where we are when it comes to marketing or exchange zones or deliverables or our brand or our advertising channels or our potential demand or how's our packaging and production doing. So we created this. So I want you to know your business model. All right. That's number 9. And number 10, my favorite. And before we go to number 10, I think we're going to just go to a very, very quick break. And yeah, that's what we're going to do. We're going to go to a quick break and then we'll be right back.
Looking to grow your existing business? America's SBDC Network can help. America's SBDC Network no-cost growth acceleration services provide in-depth consulting to assess your financials, optimize performance, uncover new opportunities, and accelerate business growth. Ready to grow? Visit us online or contact your local office to get started on your path to success today.
Welcome back to Community Business Hours here on 90.1 KPFT HD3.
All right, so here we go. The finale. I actually have the sound effects. I just don't want to push it. I'm afraid of what will happen. All right, so here's number 2. Small business owner. Business-minded person, entrepreneur, whatever you want to call yourself. If you want to grow a sustainable business, and you did last week's deal with the whole, the workflow binder thingy thing? Automation. I enjoy the movie Iron Man, the series, the whole, the three of them or however many made, with Tony Stark and Stark Industries. He's like Bill Nye, only on some other level with it, right? Automation. I'm big on automation. The scariest part about automation, if any of you are old enough to remember Star Trek or you've seen the recent one, as a kid, I used to wonder, so how do you get picked for the team? I mean, if you're down in trash or you're working the replicator, when you get to be Captain Kirk? I mean, how do you move up in this thing? You know, it's like, it's kind of scary to think that there's no jobs for humans, really. That's where we are right now. The only reason, truly, that the switch probably has not been flipped is because widespread pandemonium and chaos would break out if you realized that pretty much every white-collar job and most blue-collar jobs can be replaced by a machine. You know, the fact that when you walk into a doctor's office and you've already looked up everything there is to know, because just about everything there is to know has been placed online somewhere. You just can't decipher where it's real or false. When you talk to your financial people, when you talk to your educator, everything's online. So when you start thinking about your job as a mechanic will soon be replaced by a machine or a self-fixing car. Your job as a truck driver will be replaced by self-driving trucks. Uber will be replaced by self-driving taxi cars. And airplane pilots will be replaced by new autopilots. Automation is not the future, it's here. And you need to embrace it for everything it's worth, because when it hits, it's going to hit with an impact of a meteorite for many people. So number 10 is start to look up and get familiar with the whole concept of automation. So that's the 10. That's all I got. So I want to say thank you for tuning in today, for checking us out, listening to the Executive Entrepreneur. You know, we try our best here to, you know, give you information that's going to help you out. But we'll be back next week, every week here, Tuesday at noon, 12 p.m. Central. We're going to see what we're going to talk about. I'm pretty sure we're going to have a change to the show. If you want to follow us, go to EEThinking or EE Hour. Drop us a line. We're on Facebook, YouTube, all that good stuff. So with that said, it's been fun. Have a wonderful week, and we'll see you soon.